Yeah, so I will start sharing, or are you going to say a few words, or
Yeah,
I'll start?
let me say good morning to everybody. So, buenos días con todos. Good morning, everybody. Como sabemos, hoy día tenemos una presentación especial. As you know, today we have a special presentation. So, ya está con nosotros profesor Clau Laporte. Él es un profesor de la Universidad ETS de Canadá. He's here with us, Professor Clau Laporte. He's professor at ETS University of Canada. Él es quien nos va a dar hoy día esta gran conferencia con respecto a una variedad de temas que tienen que ver con ingeniería de software, con calidad de software y también con algunos tópicos que él topa en su libro, el libro que hemos estado utilizando como texto, y también sobre una norma muy importante que es la norma 29110. So he's here to talk with us about software engineering, about quality assurance in software engineering, about his book, and also about this, a very important standard who is made especially for small organizations. Entonces, agradezco al profesor Laporte por su presencia y le dejo para que él mismo nos cuente un poco sobre sí y pues nos dé su exposición. So I'm giving the word to Claude. So you Claude, thank you very much for being here. Can present yourself, and you know the auditor is all yours. Thank you very much again.
Thank you, Sandra. Good morning, everyone. So for the first few seconds, you're going to see my face, and then I'm going to disappear, just to make sure that Zoom does not consume all the internet bandwidth that we have between us. And I encourage you to ask questions. Your professor Sandra will be monitoring the question. And if you prefer, if you have some difficulties in English, don't worry. Ask your question to Sandra, and she will translate the questions, and then we can do it in English. Okay. So now I'm going to stop the video, and I'm going to start the presentation in a few seconds.
Voy a traducir solo en caso. El profesor Laporte lo que acaba de decir es que nos insta a todos a hacer preguntas, especialmente durante la presentación, de tal manera que el tópico no se vaya y no dejarlas hasta el final. Si ustedes desean, pueden preguntar en español y yo puedo ayudar con la traducción, o pueden preguntar directamente en inglés. Les pido de manera especial que aprovechen esta oportunidad de escuchar directamente desde el profesor Laporte las respuestas que él pueda tener a las dudas que ustedes tengan. So that's all. Thank you, Claude.
Thank you. So we are going to have a look at software quality assurance and software engineering standards. And you see a blue box at the bottom of my slide, where I say that we are celebrating 50 years of software engineering. It's 50 years plus because the first time that the word software engineering was talked about in a conference was in 1968. So now we're 50 years plus two or something like that. So a few words about myself. I've been working in the military for many years. And when I was a military officer in Canada, I was given the task as a project manager to establish a software engineering center in Canada. So I had the opportunity to visit in 1989, the Software Engineering Institute, and to meet the director of the SEI, as well as the directors of the different programs. And this is when I had the opportunity to meet Watts Humphrey, who was a visionary, was the grandfather of the CMMI and the CMM. So I had the pleasure of meeting him a few times. And this is one of the pioneer of software engineering. And then I was asked to set up a graduate program in software engineering. So it was the first master's degree in software engineering in Canada back in 1990. Then I left the military to work as a process manager, process engineering in software, in systems, and in project management, for about 7.5 years with this company that manufactures, as you can see, a weapon system, a defense weapon system. Then I work as a consultant with Bombardier, and I had the pleasure to teach courses about software engineering, about software reviews, about the management of change in Asia, in North America, and in Europe. and also did a few projects with the new, the modernized version of the subway of Montreal. And in the year 2000, so 20 years ago, I joined ETS as a professor of software engineering. And since 2002, I've been delegated by Canada to be an expert on software engineering on one of the ISO committee that I will show you later. So this is the ETS. So we have, it's an engineering school. So there is only one faculty, the Faculty of Engineering. We have 11,000 students approximately. And one very special thing about ETS is each student at the undergraduate level have to go in industry for one semester. And they are paid like an employee of that organization, and they have to go in industry during three semesters over their curriculum. So typically the student will do one or two semesters in class, then he will do one semester in an industry, he will come back for two, he will go back in industry for one semester, he will come back for two, and he will go back for one semester. And over 95% of the students have a job before they graduate from ETS. And they are paid also. I forgot to mention you that they are paid. So the content of this presentation, I will do an introduction to software engineering and my perception. We will talk about standards for very small entities. And the definition of a very small entities is an organization that has up to 25 people. So it could be a team, it could be a company, it could be a government organization, it could be a project, and it could be a department having up to 25 people. Naturally, I will be talking about software engineering 29110 standard for VSEs. I will talk about systems engineering, and systems engineering in the context of 29110 means that the product delivered to the customer has hardware and software components. Few words about 29110 in academia. I'll talk about the benefits of the standards to VSEs and their clients, their customers. I'll be talking about the next steps of my working group, because as you know, I am the editor of the working group, and I will show that in a few minutes. And I'll be talking about quality assurance and 29110 and with the conclusion. So we have about a 2 hour long presentation. Well, first thing is, what is software? Okay, but so there are different answers for different audience or different perspective. So from your perspective as a student, it's some homework, some exercise, some project that you've done with your professor, with some code, debug the code, and maybe some documentation, depending on university. Some university are very pure computer science, so there is almost no documentation, while other universities like mine are teaching software engineering, and you will see in a few minutes what I mean by software engineering. For many software developer working in industry, it's a debug code and partially tested. Okay, when I say partially, I'll show you later on that we cannot totally test software. Then for customers that are using a product for a short time, it is a tested code with some documentation. And for users of systems that are will exist for decades, like a ship, like a railway, like an airplane, those systems will have to be maintained for 20, 30, or even 40 years. Okay, so this is why there is a need for more documentation than just if you're using or developing software for a short time. So when I talk about software engineering on that scale, so on the upper part, it's more computer science, but that I mean debugged, partially coded and some minimal or no documentation, while in software engineering, it's the full set of documentation. Because remember that if a system will be maintained for 20, 30 years, most probably the people that were there initially, when the system was developed 20 to 30 or 30 years ago, they are gone, they have retired. So if you want them to transmit their knowledge, it has to be, since we don't do telepathy, at least I don't do telepathy, so we have to document, we have to put this knowledge in documents. And those are the documents that will be used in the next 20, 30 years to maintain the software, to correct defects, to add functionalities, modify functionalities, delete functionalities. So this is why for many systems and the systems I've been working with, especially in the company where I was working as a process engineer, those systems will be used for decades. So they are a library full of documentation. And this is why it costs a lot more to do software engineering than just computer science, because you could have for the same application, the same number of lines of code. But as soon as you add documentation, you're adding a lot of cost, because every page that has to be written has to be reviewed and corrected. So you can see that easily you would be adding hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of hours to a project to write that documentation. So a few years ago, in 1968, there was a first meeting where we talk about software engineering, and they were talking in those days about a software crisis. And those are the manifestation of the software crisis. So projects were over budget, were over schedule, the software was inefficient, low quality, the software did not meet the requirements, it was difficult to manage, and sometimes the software was not even delivered. Okay, so that's 52 years ago. Okay, so we build systems like the Wright brothers that built airplanes, the first airplanes that were built. They were building the thing, they were pushing off of the cliff to see if that airplane would fly, and if it crashed, they let it crash and they start all over again. So unfortunately, in those days, in the 1968, that was the paradigm, that was the approach that they were using. And we'll go back to this slide toward the end of my presentation, and I'll be asking you if things have changed since then. One thing maybe I should mention, when I was nominated as a project manager for a master's degree and also for the Software Engineering Center, I had the privilege to go and meet the best software engineers in the world. As I said, I went to the SEI, I went to the NASA in Houston, I went to the Department of Defense in Washington, and I went to see organizations in European countries. And that's in 1990, okay? And the common denominator to all the meetings I had was this. They say, the problem with software, the problem is not technical. Yes, we have technical challenge. Yes, we have to push the performance envelope, but the problem in software development is management. We don't know how to manage projects, or we manage poorly projects. Okay, so this is why, as you'll see later on, when I will introduce 29110, that we have put a project management process, because you could be excellent software developers and you can fail it at a project because you cannot manage it. Okay, so going back to the presentation. So the four dimensions of a project are the cost of execution, the cost of evaluation, the cost of correction, and the cost of prevention. So let's assume that we are all perfect and we don't make errors, then 100% of your budget, 100% of the effort of a project will be spent in cost of execution, okay? 100%. But we know that we are not perfect yet, Okay, so we do evaluations, we do testings, we do reviews. So in other words, we have to put some part of our budget in the evaluation category. Now, as you know, we find defects. So we have to correct those defects. So there is a cost associated to the correction of defects. And if we are smart, if we learn from our mistakes, from our personal mistakes, or from the mistake of the team, then we would put in place practices, we would put in place mechanisms, tools to prevent from having the same mistakes being made again and again and again on other projects. So those are the costs of prevention. And I'll show you later on a curve about that. So again, if we are perfect, okay, 100% of the cost goes in there. And since we are not perfect, we're doing evaluations. So we see, we do reviews, personal reviews, desk check reviews, inspections, testings, verification, and audits. And we do also prevention. So the training, so the study that you're doing right now at the university is part of prevention cost, okay? Because if you learn software engineering practices and you apply them while you're in university, when you'll be reaching industry, you should be more performant. You should be producing better quality software, lower cost quality software, okay? And also part of the preventions are the methodologies, the standards, the tools, the measures that you'll be doing. And unfortunately, we have to do corrections to what we've done. So when we find mistakes, when we do reviews, when we do verifications, when we do audits, we have to correct those mistakes. And Mike, so it's called cost of rework. You know, when we have to do it again, do it at the end, not totally, you don't redo the total software, but you have to modify certain modules because there were defects in certain modules. And this impacts maybe some part of the documentation. So you may have to modify one or two chapters in the documentation. It may mean that you also have to modify test cases and the documentation that goes with test cases. You have to run again those test cases and you have to document the result of those test cases. So all that is rework. All that is waste. Waste, but that I mean, if we were very clever, as I said before, 100% of our budget will go into just execution. Okay. So my question to you is, as a student, what is your own personal cost of rework or percentage of rework, I should say, in your project? Okay. Think about that while we show the next slide. So I'm asking you as a student, are you measuring your development process and your products? By development process, do you know the percentage of your budget or your effort when you do a homework or you do a project? What percentage of your time goes into each of those categories? And especially this one, okay? Because this is the one we would like to reduce. Once we know what it is, if we are intelligent, we want to reduce it. Ideally, we want to reduce it to zero, but since we're not perfect, maybe 5% will be acceptable, okay? Could be acceptable. So if you're not, if you cannot provide those process measures, my questions to you or to a company is, are you really managing your project, okay? Because no industry, if you think about, let's say, chemical industry or petroleum industry or food industry or other industry, they know the number to all those categories. And they're working very, very hard to reduce the cost of defects or the waste in their process. Because this is how they make profit. If they reduce the waste by 10%, so it means that they have, this 10% could be used for research or could be used to reduce the cost or to do some marketing or something like that, okay? Now, about those three questions, I'm asking you, do you know the density of the defects that you inject in your own software? when I say inject, I know it's not voluntary. Okay? We do mistakes, so we don't know. Okay? So those are the defects that we inject. Also, do you know the defect density of the defect that you remove from your software? And eventually, the number of defects that you deliver to your customer or to your professor. What is the quality of the product that you deliver to your customer? So if you don't know the answer to these questions, then can you really say that you're developing quality software? Okay, and my answer is no. Okay, no to the two questions on that slide. If you cannot answer those questions, you don't manage a project, okay, correctly, or you don't know about the quality. And if you don't know about the quality, how can you manage? Okay, how can you manage? So let you read this, and I'm asking you, what could be the percentage hidden behind that blue box? Okay, so 40 to 50%. So let's take that 50% as a reference point. So it means that for each hour, let's say 100 hours of a project, 50 hours goes in the trash can because we have to do things over and over again. Okay. 50% of the budget goes to the trash can because we don't do it correctly. So my proposition is, if you don't change the way you work, how can you expect better results? Okay? Nothing will happen as a miracle. Okay? It's hard work to do software engineering. So this is a very interesting article that was published a few months ago in IEEE Software. And by the way, this is what I say to my students, my graduate students, and even my undergraduate students. You should become a member of the IEEE organization. As a student, you have a lower cost of membership. And once you are a member of IEEE, you have access to the IEEE Explore website. And this allows you to have access to thousands and thousands and thousands of documents. And you have access to magazines like the IEEE Computer or the IEEE Software that are published a few times a year. So this is a column where the authors have been running this column for 10 years, and then they ask themselves, what were the impact of the software engineering people over the last 10 years? And they had a very bad perception. Okay, so you say that in software, we jump to the next fad. Okay? It looks like the best thing in town is to have the latest tool, the latest methodology, the latest approach. And the problem is we don't learn from the previous methodologies, the previous tool, the previous process that we've been using before. So we adopt a new one and we throw the previous one in the garbage can, roughly. So the author says, if we want to be an engineering discipline, we have to systematically learn from our mistakes. This is how all engineering disciplines and all disciplines, not only engineering, all disciplines are improving. I remember seeing a quote from one of the musician that was about 90 years old, and he was playing a violin and he was practicing 2-3 hours a day. And they were asking him, why are you practicing 2-3 hours a day? You're 90 years old. He says, there is always place for improvement. Okay. And other engineering disciplines are measuring and they are improving their products, like the motor of a car or the motor of a jet engine. Okay. The reliability and the durability have improved by order of magnitudes, not by a factor of 10, but factor of thousands, maybe tens of thousands, since we first produced the first jet engine, because those engineering disciplines are measuring at every step of the process, and they have to find ways to get it better. But unfortunately, in software, we don't like to measure. Okay, and I'll go back to this thing at the end of the presentation, and I'll be asking you why. Why are we not measuring? Why are we afraid to measure ourselves? So a little story about Dr. Semmelweis. So the blue box says that this story happened before Louis Pasteur discovered the germs, okay? So the germ theory, okay? So just to put you in perspective. So Dr. Semmelweis was hired to a clinic, a bird clinic in Vienna. And in that hospital, in the Vienna hospital, there were two clinics, two separate clinics. One clinic was ran by professors and medical professors and medical students. And the mortality rate in that clinic of women was 10%. And there was another clinic that had a mortality rate of only 3%. Okay. So when Dr. Semmelweis was hired, he became the titular, the boss of the clinic, of the first clinic, where the death rate of women was very high. So high that women didn't want to give birth to their baby in that clinic. They preferred the other clinic because, as you can see, there is a factor of three difference in the death rate between one clinic and another. So, as you can guess, the two clinics had very similar medical techniques because the process of giving birth to a baby is the same. Okay, whether you go in the clinic, the first clinic or the second clinic, the process is the same. Okay? And it's been the same for thousands and thousands of years. So, as I said, measurement is very important. So, Semmelweis took some measures to make sure that what he was hearing about was not just one circumstance or one event happening in 1 month. So he went back a few years down the road, as you can see, 5 years back, and you can see that the percentage of dead people, dead mother, was much bigger in the first clinic than in the second clinic. So the next step, he says, what could be the differences between those two clinics? And he found the major difference were the people in those clinics. So first clinic, as I said, medical students with medical professors, with surgeons, so people studying medicine. And as they were studying medicine, naturally they were doing autopsy. They were doing dissection. So you can expect, if you saw movies, you know that when you're doing dissections or surgery, you will have blood in your hands. Okay, and then they would switching from doing autopsy, doing surgery, to giving birth to women. And once that was done, then they went back to do surgery and autopsies and things like that. In the second clinic, it was staffed by midwives. And the only thing that they were doing in that clinic was giving birth to babies. Okay, the only thing. So, in the April of that year, the death rate was over 18%. And Semmelweis noticed that one of the students in the medical school of that clinic cut himself when he was doing an autopsy. He cut himself with a scalpel. He didn't cut a finger, but he made burden, okay? And there was some blood that was coming out of that thing. And the few days after that, that medical student got symptoms very similar to the symptoms that the mother were having when they were dying of that fever. So he had fever and eventually died. So Semmelweis says, maybe there is something in what we touch that is affecting the woman that we are treating. So he said, let's institute a policy where students and medical students will wash their hands between examinations of patients between doing autopsy and giving birth to patients. And he did that in May, okay? And then in June, the mortality rate went down by 2.2%. So a factor of of 9 almost, okay? Almost 9, 8, factor of 8, okay? In 1 month. So normally we would have say, hey, Eureka, we found the solution. Let's celebrate, let's have a party. We found a way to reduce the mortality rate by 16% by using very simple thing, just washing your hands. So no high tech, okay? No sophisticated equipment, not expensive equipment, very low tech. Okay? So you would have expected things to work well. Okay? And then Semmelweis says, if there is some mysterious thing that we carry in our hands, maybe our tools also could be impacted by that. So he said, let's also wash the tools in the same solution. And the result was that he almost eliminated totally the fever of pregnant woman. Okay. So having said that, you would have said, no problem, we found the solution. We have just to implement this hand washing and tool washing policy, and voila, okay, we don't have any problem anymore. But the problem came because in those days, the paradigm was that those germs or disease were spreading through in the air. They were in the air, okay? While Semmelweis were saying, no, it's physical and we carry them in our fingers. One thing. So he was, in other words, he was going against the known knowledge at that time. And second thing, surgeons were gentlemen, okay, and they were offended by the fact that Semmelweis were asking them to wash their hands, because they say, we as gentlemen, we don't have dirty hands, so we will not wash our hands, right? So this is a result of, okay, of that story, okay? He's, now we come with it's called the Semmelweis reflex, where we reject almost as a reflex new knowledge that contradicts existing norms or paradigm. And I'm going to open a parenthesis here. A few months ago in the New York Times, there was an article, very exciting article, where they say, if we want the society to move in certain directions, let's say about medical treatment, we almost have to wait until the surgeons and the medical people of that generation are dead, such that new generations of doctors and nurses and medical people will adopt new techniques and new approaches. So he went that far that we have to wait one generation to wait for the old people to die, such that we can move forward with new things. So I'm closing the parenthesis here. So my questions to you, is it possible that people involved in software, okay, not only developers, but also customers, managers, and maybe professor could experience the Semmelweis reflex? So a discussion for you for tonight over a beer. So this is an extract from the Boston Globe newspaper back in 2014, where they give numbers about the number of people that die in American hospitals because the medical people do not wash their hands. And they say that only a modest improvement could bring us a 50% reduction in those dead people and also in the cost. Okay. So one hospital found a way to reduce, to motivate their doctors and their nurses to wash their hands, to reach a high level of compliance. Okay. So to reach 80% of compliance, and 80% may sound right, but it means that 20% of the people in a clinic or an hospital are not washing their hands. So they're going from one patient to another, from one room to another, with what I call dirty hands, okay? So how did they achieve that 80% compliance? Is by offering free tickets to movies. So imagine you have a very sophisticated people trained in medical technologies, some that are brain surgeons or heart surgeons, and to motivate them to wash their hands, you have to give them movie tickets. Isn't that strange? But my question is, could this apply also to software people? So are there analogies between germs in the medical environment and what we call software bugs in software? First question. And are there analogies between the medical people and the software people? So let's answer those two questions. So analogies between the germs and the word bug, and I will be getting rid of the word bug in a few minutes, but for now, for that presentation, I'll keep the word bugs. So germs are not visible to human beings. Okay, we have to use a microscope or something like that. Okay, but germs can be counted. Okay, you can count the number of bacteria, you can count the number of things using known techniques, using microscopes and things like that. Bugs are not visible for, unfortunately, most of the developers. Okay, it's not because they are blind. Okay, it's because they don't look at the right thing. Okay, and also bugs can be identified and bugs can be counted. Okay, and bugs can be identified using software reviews, as an example. And so the medical people have developed practices to get rid of germs, and we in the software engineering domain, since at least year 1970, we have developed techniques to detect and correct defects. Okay, defects. You see here, I'm not talking about the word bugs. I'm talking about the word defects. It's not the same thing. The word bug comes from the 1947 computer that was the size of a house. And the operator found that their computer during that they didn't work correctly. So she took a lamp, a flashlight, and she went around and she found out that there was a bug caught in one of the relay of the computer. And she removed the bug out of the computer and the computer started to work correctly. And what you see here is a photocopy or a copy of the logbook of the operator. And she took the bug that she found in the computer and she put it in her logbook with a scotch tape on it. So this is what you see. You see the actual first computer bug that is being scotched on the logbook of the computer operator. Okay, but in software engineering, there are no bugs. There are errors injected by developers. And this is the product that we use to kill bugs. Okay. So we human beings, we make human errors, which sometimes, most of the time, produce defects, one or many defects. And those defects may produce one or more failure. So the big questions are, how can we prevent those errors? How can we prevent the human beings from making those errors? And how do we detect those defects? Because we are not perfect. Okay, we will try to reduce the error development, the error injection, but the other technique, the other tool that we have is for those errors that we did not find, we have to find other ways during the process to detect them. So analogy between medical staff and medical people. So the medical staff, they still think, even today, that they don't have to wash their hands because they don't have dirty hands. Okay, when I say still today, I could go on Google and I will find articles, recent articles, that still talk about medical people that do not wash their hands in hospitals even today, okay? And same thing for software developers. They have such a big ego sometimes that they don't make errors. Okay, other people make errors, but not themselves. They're too great, they're too good for that. Okay, they're the best, okay? Medical products are not used by medical staff, typically the product to wash their hands. And same thing for software people is sometimes software quality practices are ignored or not used by many, many people and many managers. And unfortunately, we treat symptoms. We try to kill the bug, but we don't focus on the causes. What made that developer to make an error that eventually became a defect and eventually became a failure? So we have to work on the cause. Otherwise, at the end of the day, someone will have to pay for that. Okay, either you as a patient in an hospital, or you as a customer, future or actual customer of a deficient software product. Let's move in time to the year 2000. Michael Fagan is the inventor of the software inspection. So it's a technique to identify defects. So the history is as follows. Michael Fagan was a manager at IBM back in the 1970. And originally he was the manager of the production chain or production facility that were making chips. So the chips that goes into your computer, into your cellular phone. So they're made like on a wafer, and on each wafer you have dozens or hundreds of chips that eventually you break apart and you insert to in a computer. So they have learned the hard way that in hardware, if you don't detect the defects, then you have to scrap all the chips that you've made if you find defects afterward. So they have developed in the hardware facilities techniques to identify defects before the chips were made. So eventually, Fagan was moved to the software division of IBM and in 1971, and he discovered that there were about 30 to 80% of waste or rework in the software development process, which was totally unacceptable. I mean, if you had 30 to 80% waste in the chips manufacturing process, the company would be out of business within a few days. Okay? No company can sustain 30 to 80% waste. No company can sustain that. But in software, it looks like we accept that for stupid reasons. So he said, let's apply the knowledge that we gain in the hardware development process. Let's apply this knowledge in the software developing process. And he developed the inspection process to detect defects in the products at each step of the process of the software development process, at each step. And I will show that to you in a few minutes. And also, let's find out what are the defects in the process that we use to develop the software. Because if we don't remove the defects in the process, then the next time when we're doing another project, we will have, again, defects. So Fagan decided to deploy this technique, this inspection technique in this department. And I'll let you read what his colleagues, managers of other software departments told him. Okay. So I contacted Michael Fagan a few years ago by email and asked him, so since that article was written, what is your opinion about the implementation of inspection? And you can see here his statement. So after 40 years, we're still either not well understand or we poorly execute the process and we don't get the full potential of the inspection process. And I'll show you later example of what we mean by full potential. Full potential means that you can detect 95% of defects on the spot where they were developed. Okay, so during the process, at every step of the process, you have put in place tools, you have put in place practices that allows you to detect 95%, 98% of the defects. So the question back to you is, remember the objections or the obstructions, the opposition of the surgeons with Semmelweis? We still have the same thing even today, okay? At least 100 years later, we still have the same mentality with the software people, okay? This is a statement from Watts Humphrey at the SEI. Watts Humphrey, the father, or one of the father of software engineering. So I'll let you read this. So if you know that you're making mistakes, then why don't you invest time to detect those mistakes, those errors, right? So the challenges that you as software developers will have when you graduate from university is your boss will ask you to develop faster, better quality, cheaper software. It asks you to be more productive, no delays, okay? No cost overrun, and your boss or your company want to be first on the market, okay? And unfortunately, most people don't know how to develop software, but the secret is if you don't aim for better quality, you'll never be able to achieve the other objectives, never. So it's simple, eh? It's you try to develop the best software possible using the best software process and technique possible. And this will allow you to be faster, cheaper, more productive, etc. Okay. So when customers want to do business with the VSC, so what do they have in mind? So they say, no, if I do a contract with the VSC, I eventually get the product I want within the budget and within the schedule? What are my risks if I do business with a VSC? Okay, my business risk. Because if I want a software product for such a date, it's because I want to use it the next day, either internally for other workers in my company, or externally I want to sell that product to customers. So I want to make money out of that. So if I don't get it in time, then I'm losing money. As an example. And if I don't get all the functionality, then my product has less value. And the question also is, once I sign the contract with the VSC, what do I do to make sure that I will eventually get my product within time and budget? And if I want to keep this software product for many, many, many years, will this VSC give me maintenance services for the next 5 years, maybe 10 years? So those are the point of view of the customer. And I'll show you later on that the 29110 series of standards and guides will help the customer to obtain the product that he wants. Okay. There is no miracle, there is no guarantee, but you're increasing the confidence level that the customer will get what he wants. Now, from the point of view of a VSC, the VSC is asking itself, how do I get known by potential customers? Because they don't know me, I'm small, maybe I'm a startup. How do I get known to potential partners, investors, customers? How do I demonstrate that I have the capacity, I have the everything that is needed to produce the software requested by my customer? What are my risks to do a project with this customer? And also, maybe I will have to hire new developers. And if this project has a schedule of 2 months, I don't want my developers to take 2-3 weeks to learn about the product and the software before they become productive. How do I get them to be more productive? And from the point of view, and 29110, as I will show you later on, will help VSCs achieve those objectives. Now, questions similar from academia, and they want to teach to their students the best, the newest methodologies, the newest languages, with the newest tools, and also they asking themselves, how do how do I know that what we're teaching is what industry wants? Okay. Sometimes there is a big gap between what academia is teaching and what industry is requesting. But what we've learned, and I'll show you later on, is 29110 could be used and be taught by people in universities, by either undergraduate students or graduate students. And I've been doing that for about 15 years at my university, and I'll show you later on that there are at least 20 other countries that are doing the same thing. Okay, let's go back to quality. So this is an article from a magazine that was produced by the Department of Defense in USA. And the author is Watts Humphrey, again, from the Software Engineering Institute. And I'm asking you to guess what's the number of defects injected per 1,000 of line. And if you look at the title at the top of the slide, those are metrics captured by teaching PSP, TSP, and software engineering courses to a bunch of over 800 experienced engineers. So those are not students, those are people with industrial experience. And we're not talking about a bunch of 6 to 8 data points, we're talking about 800 data points, okay? So what is the number hidden? So 100 defects per 1,000 line of code, typically, okay? And the bad news is there is a wide variation between one developer to another. Typically, what he says here, there is a factor of 6 about from the most productive or the one that inject less defects to one that inject more defects, there is a factor of 6. And I'll show you later that it could be even worse. Now, the problem with software is for every branch of software, you have to do, you have to test this branch. Okay, so if you have 16 switches, then you would have maybe, you will have 70 possible paths to from point A to point B. So 70 test cases, that's easy to do, okay? But we have only, in this case, 16 different switches. But imagine if we have hundreds of switches, then it gets to numbers, which means that the bottom line is you cannot test all of your software. It's totally impossible. So if you know that, you should be doing other things. But unfortunately, many organizations are still working like they were working in the 1970s, okay? And they only do tests. They don't do other things to improve quality. So here we have a graph, and at the bottom we have the steps or the stages of a waterfall software development approach. So we have the start of the project, REQ means requirements phase, HLD means high level design, LLD means low level design, we have the code, unit testing, integration testing, and eventually system testing, and shipping the product to the customer. So typically, we inject defects at each step of the process, and hopefully, once the code is done, hopefully, if we're not too bad, we don't inject new defects. And I'll tell you later that's not the case, but let's say for now that we don't inject new defects. So how and where do we detect defects? So when the code is ready, we start doing the unit testing, integration testing, and system testing. And at the end, we ship to the customer a product with a certain number of defects left in it. So a certain number, for some company, they don't know that number. Okay? So that could be bad. Okay? In other words, you're delivering a product with all the functionalities, but with many defects, and you don't know the percentage of defects left in the code. That's bad. Okay. Now, my question to you is, what are the problems with this approach? Let you think about that for a few seconds. And here there is a list of issues. So the defects that we make in the early stage of the cycle, let's say in the requirements phase, we find them only when we have code. That's not very intelligent, right? If we rely only on tests, we will not detect all the defects. Okay. This means that we will have to do a lot of rework because we'll find a lot of defects at the end of when we'll be doing the testings. And it means that we'll have to go back and modify the requirements, modify the test cases, modify the architecture, and run the test and modify the documentation. And that means that we could have a very unstable environment, because if you have a team that are working on 10 or 20 defects at the same time at different places in the products, you could have a very unstable environment, especially if the configuration management process is not mature. You could end up into chaos. And you'll find out eventually in industry what I mean by chaos. You'll find out soon enough. And people will get frustrated. And unfortunately, the company has wasted effort and money, and the product will be delivered probably late. So I'm not asking you to work faster. I'm asking you to work more intelligently, to use the proven practices that are there, that your professors are teaching you. So same curve, okay? But now I introduce software reviews, okay, with an effectiveness of 50%. So what it means that we detect one error out of two at 50% level. But one error out of two, it's better than nothing in the first few phases of the development cycle. So in the requirements, in the high level and low level design, we discover defects. Okay, and if we discover them, we fix them right there on the spot. Okay, so when we find defects in the requirements, we connect the requirements and we move along and we develop the high level design, we do a review, we find defects, and we correct the high level design and we go on. So my question is, are you using reviews to detect defects at each step of your software development process? I'll let you to answer these questions. Okay, again, you should be working more intelligently by using reviews. This is the only tool we have, okay? Unless you're using formal methods all the way with formal requirements and formal code generators and things like that, if you're using text, simple text, okay, that we use like when you read a book, this is very informal, and this is where there is a place for mistakes and errors and interpretations and things like that. Now my question, okay, so again, bottom are the different phases of a typical project, okay? And my question to you is, what is your defect injection profile? How many defects do you inject when you do a project for each step of the process? And just for your information, there is a variation of about a factor of 10 between one developer and another. So one developer can inject, let's say, 10 defects per 1,000 lines of code, and another developer can inject 100 defects per 1,000 lines of code. Same thing when they work on requirements. One software developer can inject 10 defects per page, and another one can inject 20 or 30 defects per page. Okay. So those are numbers from a real company. Okay. I was presenting 29110 standard at the system engineering conference, and the speaker after or before me was presenting those slides, and he was kind enough to give me a copy of his slides that I could use in my presentation. So what I show you is at the requirements stage, in that company, and by the way, this company is working in the aerospace domain. So this is a sophisticated, mature, high-tech company, right? It shows here that 49.1% of the defects are injected in the requirements. And another 20% are injected in the preliminary and detailed design. So it means that 70% of the defects are injected before one line of code is written. And most people, most software developers, are just waiting until they have code to do testings to eventually find out that there were error made in the requirements to work and do it all over again. So that's not very intelligent. Okay? And as I said, most organizations will discover the defects only in testing. And now you understand why we waste 40 to 50% of our budget or effort in the reworking, in doing a rework. It's because we're not intelligent. Okay, we're not intelligent. Okay, if I erase this slide a bit, okay, again, one mistake out of two is made in the requirements phase. And this will have an impact through all the complete development cycle if they're not caught. Right? Okay. What is your defect detection profile? Again, it varies by a factor of 10 between developers. So on one side of the spectrum, you could have very bad developers that inject 10 times more defects and that detect 10 times less defects. And on the other side of the spectrum, you have very proficient, very good developers that inject just a tenth of that and identify most of that, right? So this is the defect detection profile of the same organization. So if you look at the top, you see that they have defect detection of 96%, 94%, 96.8% and things like that. But it means that in the requirements phase where they show 96%, it means that 96% of the defects that have been injected are detected in the requirements. 96.8% of the defects that have been injected in preliminary design are detected. And I'll show you later on that 29110 can help you eventually achieve those numbers. So don't hope to get 96% defect detection from day one, because you have to learn to find defects. Even though they are sitting on a page in front of your eyes, you don't see them until you do proper inspections and proper reviews with checklists, and then you discover them. And then you become better. And as you become better, your defect detection efficiency will go from 50% to 60% to 70% to 80%. And if you have 2-3 people working on the same document, then it can go up to the 96, 95, 98% level, okay? So it's no secret, it's no magic. It's plain hard work, discipline work, engineering work, okay? Okay, let's move now to the second stage. We'll be talking about VSEs. But before we talk about VSEs, those are the laws of nature that support engineering discipline. And this one, the Ohm's law, is the one that you use most of the time without you knowing it, when you flip a switch, when you open the lights and things like that, you open your computer, your cell phone, the Ohm's law is activated, and as you know, it works well. And what we mean by a law of nature, it's always true within our domain, whether it is Friday, Monday, it doesn't depend on the developers or the engineer, it's always true. So mechanical engineers, chemical engineers, electrical engineers have learned that you cannot fool around with the law of nature. The law of nature will always win, okay? If you try to play around with the law of nature, it will fight back and you will lose. So my question to you is, could you name a law of nature that is a foundation for software engineering? I'm not hearing anything, so maybe you're still thinking about it. But the answer is this, okay? There is nothing like that in software engineering. And this is one of the problems that we have compared with other engineering disciplines. But the good news is we have standards, and standards are documented knowledge documented from failed and successful project. So you see the curve here from back from the 1987 to last year, the curve that's going up. So that, what does this mean? It means that there is an international consensus from experts in software engineering from all over the world that have decided that such and such practices in software engineering, like configuration management or measurement or risk management or project management or requirements development, if they are done correctly, they will improve the level of confidence that we'll be delivering good products. So we've learned this knowledge from failed project and from successful project over the last 30 to 40 years. Okay, so this is the good news. We don't have laws of nature, but we have a standard, and I'll show you a few standards in a few minutes. So this is one way for you to find out the equivalent of the law of nature is to obtain the standard. And if I go back to, and I don't want to do publicity for IEEE. I've been a member of IEEE for 40 years, but if you become a member of IEEE, then you have access to the IEEE Explore website, and you would have access to dozens and dozens of software engineering standards at no more cost. So once you've paid your membership, you have access to not only the articles, but you will have access to the latest version of the software engineering standards. Okay, closing the marketing pitch for IEEE. So why do we use standard? So I'll let you read this. So there are very many useful ways to use software standards or system standards. But unfortunately, the standards cannot guarantee you that you will be delivering quality, but it will give you, it will increase the level of confidence. In other words, lower the risk. It will lower the risk of delivering bad software, blowing the budget and the schedule. Okay, so quick look at the House of Quality. So we know, since the back to the 1970s, we have learned from success and failure, and we have documented that in articles, in standards, and in books. So the foundation of quality assurance, from left to right, you have standards and models like the CMMI. You have quality models. You have traceability. You have configuration management practices, review practices. You have measures, how to measure. There is a specific standard about measurement. Verification and validation. A quick look is verification. You're checking if you are doing the thing right. And validation, you're checking if you're doing the right thing. Okay. So verification, are we doing the things right? In other words, no defects, and it meets the requirements. And then we ask ourselves, are we doing the right thing? In other words, is it what the customer wants? And if we move on the right side, we have the cost of quality, the business models, and the risk management. Business models, the reason why I've put that there, it's because for a different domain of business, whether if you work in the automotive environment, or you work in the nuclear environment, or you work in other domains, they have different risks. Okay, so they adopt different practices to minimize the risks. So this is why it's good to know the different business models to select the proper tools, the proper methods, the proper practices to lower the risk of that business model. Then for a particular project, you document the practices that you have selected for this specific project out of what I've shown here. Okay, so you out of those toolbox, of that toolbox, you select what you need and you document it in this quality assurance plan. And this will allow you to develop quality software to have stable process, capable process, and to have competitive, productive, and motivated employees. All that with some minimal support from quality assurance. It could be one people of the team working part-time. It could be one people on the team working full-time in QA, quality assurance. Sometimes there is a quality assurance team when the company is big, and sometimes there is a quality assurance department when you have large company. And bigger company, they have quality assurance division with dozens, if not hundreds of people. And to make everything to work correctly, then you need proper, strong management support, because the management is the one that is putting quality assurance in the budget to hire the people and to pay for the practices that will be eventually applied in different projects. Okay. Let's have a look at the VSEs again. But oh, sorry, I forgot one thing. Yes, it's the introduction of VSE, but from another approach. On the left side, you see models and standards. Okay, so here is a snapshot of the portfolio of standards that are available, and there are standards that covers everything. The vocabulary, okay, we have process standard, we have product standards, we have quality standard, testing standard, documentation standard, management standard, risk standards, etc., etc. Okay, so there is now a portfolio of standards that will allow you to build, develop, or maintain quality software. And one of those standards that's part of the portfolio of the ISO standard, it is the 29110 standards series for VSEs. So are VSEs important? This is data from European Union. So here you see that for company that have from 1 to 9 employees, in European countries, there are 92% of the companies in the European Union are micro enterprises. And if you look at the second category, 10 to 49, you add another 6%. So 98% of the companies in Europe have less than 49 employees. So this is the target population of our standard. Our standard, as you remember, is targeting a company with up to 25 people. So we are targeting the 95%, 96% of the companies that you see in Europe. Now, what about the big companies? So in Europe, companies with up to 250 people, with higher than 250 people, sorry, there is only 0.2%, okay? There are only 0.2%. So this is why we have those pyramids, the industrial pyramid. So for every big company, this company is supported by prime suppliers, by suppliers, and by producers. And this is a pyramid of a Japanese manufacturer of electronic products. And the number that you see are the actual number of for that company. Okay? And a few years ago, one of the producer at the very low level produced a component, software component, with a defect that was not detected and was injected in the product that was sold to thousands and thousands of customers, and they had to do corrections, modifications, and recalls, and the cost was $200 million. So for that defect, the cost was $200 million. Now, going back to VSEs, there are VSEs at every level of that pyramid, that chain of producers. Even at the top level, they have VSEs, they have small teams, they have small projects, they have small departments, okay? So the standard is applicable at all level of that pyramid. So back in 2005, when I joined ISO for that working group, I made some observations. So the observation I made were as follow, is I discovered, and we discovered, that the software engineering standard in those days, in 2005, have not been designed for VSEs. Okay. They have been designed by experts of large companies to serve the needs of large companies. But unfortunately, VSEs was not part of that audience of standards. And VSE have a negative perception of standard because of the cost, because of the documentation that standard requires, and it looks like it's a bureaucracy. Yeah. And many VSEs have had up a chaotic process. Most of the time it's not documented. The process is between the ear of developers. So how can you improve a process that is part of is in the head of a developer if we cannot do telepathy? So you have to have some documented process to be able eventually to identify improvements and defects. And the product made by VSE is very important to the world economy. So my vision was to eventually to have VSEs around the world to work with on a daily basis with standards that have been adapted to their needs, adapted to their size, adapted to their context, and to help them to become more competitive. Okay. And to do that, I decided to participate, and I've been participating as a project editor since 2005, now 15 years, to that working group. And also I'm working very hard to accelerate the adoption and implementation of a standard, because it's not because there is a beautiful standard that people will jump and will start adopting it tomorrow. Okay. There is no miracle. Okay. And this is why I thank Sandra to invite me today to talk to you, because I will have the opportunity to talk to you about the 29110 standard. So at the end of the day, you will be knowing more than yesterday about 29110, and also to develop educational material. So there are many committees within ISO, and there is a subcommittee 7, which is mandated to develop systems and software engineering standard. I remember you when I talk about system, it means there is some hardware. And my working group 24, which had been established in 2005, you see the flags of the countries and the logo of a few institutions. So those are the flags or logo of organizations that participated since 2005 to the development of 29110 series. So you can see we have a wide spectrum of countries, from a wide spectrum of continents. We have people from Asia, from America, and from European countries. So back in 2005, we decided we wanted to find out what were the problem of VSEs. So we did a survey, and the survey was to identify the needs and the problems of VSE. So we did a survey in 9 languages, sorry, to make sure that people from different countries could really understand what we were asking them. And the problems that we had, or the findings that we had from that survey, is just a few percent, 18% were certified, but a large number, 74%, they indicated that they wanted to be recognized or certified either nationally or internationally. So they wanted to have some certification saying that they are meeting a standard. And a vast majority were asking for a guidance and example, and also 55% were asking for lightweight standard with templates and things like that. So let's move into the 29110. So here you have the spectrum of approaches. The horizontal axis on the right side is for very high ceremony, well-documented process with a requesting from you a lot of documentation. So those are typical of the space industry, of the aerospace industry, the medical industry, the nuclear industry. Okay. And on the left side, you have the low ceremony with little documentation and light or sometimes no documented process. Okay. And on the vertical axis on the top, you have the waterfall approach with almost no risk. okay, or few risks, and with a sequential development approach. Now, this, you know, almost never do that, except in some very large projects, which they abandoned. They have found that they find it easier sometimes to manage a waterfall approach, but that approach has a lot of problems, and we will not talk about that today. At the bottom, you have the iterative approach, risk-driven, continuous integration and testing. So we have position 29110 right in the middle of that spectrum, where yes, you have to use a documented process. Yes, you have to write some documentation. Yes, you can have different life cycles if you want to work waterfall, if you want to work agile, if you want to work iterative, 29110 will allow you to do that, okay? And to help you grow from one stage to another, from, let's say, a startup to a mature organization, we have developed a set of four guides for profiles from, and I will explain to you in a few seconds. So the small one, the small Russian doll, the entry profile, is a subset of the basic profiles. In other words, when you have put in place the practices of the entry process, then to move to the basic process is just a matter of adding a few tasks. And you can then move to the intermediate profile by adding a few tasks to the basic profile, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? So the four stages are the initial or the entry profile. So startups or small project, typical of a student's project, 6-person months or so. Okay? And then the basic profile, one project with one team. Okay. The intermediate profile is you have more than one project with more than one team doing projects in parallel. Okay. So it means you have a little bit more of administration to do, to manage many projects at the same time. You have to manage the resources, you have to manage tools and things like that. Okay. And the advanced profile is what we want to help you to grow and sustain, because we know that startups, they don't live very long. A high percentage of startups die. When I say high, about 80% of software startups die within the first 5 to 7 years. So if we know that, we can help them to grow a step at a time, such that they become more mature, they make good product, they have happy customer, they make good money, and they can produce new products, and they can eventually have more than one team in parallel, and eventually they will be going for bigger contracts or bigger projects. Okay. So we have developed the guides of the entry profile and the basic profile are both available in Spanish and also available free on the ISO website. And if you cannot find them, you can ask your professor and she'll be able to tell you where to go. And I'll show you in a few seconds an address for that. So we have developed different documents for different audience. So the overview document is for everyone. It's the introduction to the 29110. And then we have standards. So standards tells you what to do, okay? So standards are a list of requirements telling you what to do. So to help VSEs, we have developed guides, and the guides tell you how to do things, how to do the project management, how to do the software development, okay? And as I said before, a few of those documents are freely available on the ISO website. just for your information, I mentioned a few minutes ago, is Mexico, Peru, and Uruguay have developed Spanish version of part one and part five. And people in Mexico have developed very recently, and Mexico has published just a few months ago, a Mexican version of the entry profile with the deployment packages that I'll be talking to you about also in Spanish. And since five countries work together, Colombia, Costa Rica, Mexico, Peru, and Spain, ISO allows a standard to be published in a language if five countries work together and agree about the terminology used in that standard. So this is, to my knowledge, this is the first software engineering standard ever published by ISO in Spanish. Okay, and it is also available freely on the ISO website. So it's a first, it's a first thing. So it means that countries collaborated together to produce this official version of this part one, the overview. Now let's have a look at the basic profile. So we have a customer, or you have a customer, it could be your professor, but it could be a customer that comes with a description of work, a list of things that they want you to do to develop a product. And the VSE will have to make a decision to do the project or not do the project. If the project is within the competence of the VSE will say, okay, we are interested to do the project. Then the project management process will be activated and a project plan will be developed. Once the project plan is approved, then it will be used to control the project. And the typical activities of software engineering will be implemented. Okay. So you recognize the requirements analysis, architecture, software construction, integration, and testing. Okay. So as the project is being performed, there will be evaluation against the project plan. So in other words, are we slipping the schedule? Are we slipping the budget? Do we have to do the request for modification to modify the requirements because we have some technical problem? So we do evaluate a few times, maybe one time, but we do evaluate against the project plan, the progress of the project. And eventually, we finish the project, we put together the documentation requested by the customer and the software, and we close the project and we deliver what we call the software configuration, the tests, maybe the test code, the code, and the user manual, maybe the installation manual, whatever the customer has requested. Now, don't see those white boxes as waterfall, okay? This is just for illustration purposes. See those white boxes of the project management process and the software implementation process as Lego boxes, Lego blocks. So you can implement those Lego blocks in waterfall, but you can implement them in other life cycles, styles like iterative, incremental, or if you want to work in agile mode, okay? So this is just for illustration purposes. Again, we have put the project management process because we know that software developers are not very good at managing projects, and software developers are not very motivated to do project management. But we also know that if you don't manage your project correctly, you may fail. Okay? You may never deliver the product, and most probably you will have a very unhappy customer, and your company may go bankrupt. Okay? So this is why we have project management. So if you now look at the process on the left, right? The project management process with the four boxes in white, so they are there. So here you have the activities. So the second level, we have at the top level, the process. The process is composed of four activities: planning, execution, evaluation, and closure. We have input products, in this case, description of the things that you have to do, statement of work. You have internal work product, like minutes of meeting, verification document, validation document, and you have eventually output products, things that you will be delivering to your customer. Now, if we look inside an activity, we will have a set of tasks. So I'll give you an example of a task of the software implementation process, and it is a task of the requirements analysis activity. So remember, we had on the right side of my slide, we had the software implementation process, and we had the five or six white boxes. So those were activities, and for each activity, there are a series of tasks. So on the left side, you have the roles, the two roles, so the customer and the analyst participate to this particular task. And this particular task asks to validate and obtain approval of the requirement specification. And here you have some additional text to explain the meaning of that one sentence, that task statement sentence. naturally, to execute this task, you need an input. And the input are the requirement specification that have been verified. In other words, we did a review and we removed defects. And now we're ready to validate this document with the customer. And at the end of that task, okay, we should have the result of validation. And also we should have the new version of the software requirements, which now has a different status. It moves from verified to validated. Okay? So the customer has approved the specification. Now they are frozen and they are stable. And from that, you can start working on the architecture, software cases, test cases, and things like that. As an example, if you work using the waterfall approach. We also provide in the guide, and just for information, so every process has a set of activity, and every activity has a set of tasks, and this is how they are documented in the guide. It's like a recipe book where you have to follow the steps to prepare a meal. It's exactly the same thing. And we also provide description of the different work product. So as an example, the output of that task was the result of validation. So this is the title of that document. And it says it documents the validation execution and it contains the following information. Okay. So we want to make sure that we have a proof that we have validated the document with the customer, and eventually that customer would sign the minutes of the meeting or the result of the document of the validation, saying that it approves the requirement specification and maybe with a few modification, and this becomes the baseline, okay? And this is a demonstration when you want to get certified, when auditors go to your company, then they will ask you for evidence that you have executed your process, then this document, the result of validation, is a work product that demonstrate that you have executed the task that I've shown on the previous slide. Okay. And yes. Okay. So we have also developed deployment packages to facilitate the implementation of the basic profile. And so in those deployment packages, we have added some information. So we are getting, as I said, we are now in the how to do things. So we have processes, activities, tasks, and steps. We have added templates, examples, and checklists, and even some mappings to ISO 9001 or other models. Okay, and these are the nine deployment packages that support the basic profile. They have been translated in Spanish by University of Peru. And they are also available at no cost on my website, or maybe somewhere else on the internet too. Let's have a look at a few projects that have applied 29110. So a startup in Peru, a startup of four people that use the basic profile in an agile mode. And their project had over 882 hours. And the percentage of rework was 18%. A small cosmetic developer with one software developer used Entry product or Entry guide to work on a 371-hour project with a percentage of rework of 12%. And an IT startup developed with the basic profile web services software with 12.6% rework. And I told you before that the definition of VSC includes small teams in large organizations. So here is an example of a very large service provider here in Montreal that provides electricity to 8 million people in Quebec. And it had almost, as you can see, it has almost 2,000 people in the software division, and they support 2,000 applications. But like in any organization, they have also small teams of developers. So one of my graduate students was an employee of that organization and was a member of that team. And she used a the basic profile with Scrum on a 1500 hour software project with a percentage of rework at 9.6%. So what you see here is a curve from a real company called Raytheon, the name is on the upper right, where they showed that the percentage of rework went from 41% to 18% to 11% to 6%, eventually to 5%. Okay, so I will be positioning the VSC that you saw on the previous slide. So the startup in Peru at 18% rework, the startup in Tunisia at 12% rework, the service provider of utility 9.6, and the cosmetic developer 12%. So what I want to illustrate is, even if those organizations, most of them have used 29110 basic profile or entry profile for the first time to do a first project, the percentage of rework is much, much smaller than what I've shown before, you know, the 40 to 50% rework. Now, this curve shows also the level of maturity, the CMM level, the five CMM level, here I've shown it four, of that company. And it shows that it moves in maturity, the percentage of rework went down from 41% to eventually 5%. So what I want to demonstrate here is by implementing proven practices of 29110, it accelerated the maturity of the VSEs. Okay, so in the first project, when they use for the first time the 29110, they had a very low rework percentage of rework. Okay, so let's have a quick look at the Peruvian company called BitPerfect that used the basic profile. So this is remember the cost of quality, the prevention, execution, evaluation, and collection cost. So they have computed that from the beginning of the project to the end. And those are the total at the bottom. So by the way, when you do your capstone project, you can capture that data from your own project. Okay, and eventually you can make an analysis of that data to find out the lessons learned about yourself or about the team. So this organization, as I said, at 18% of rework. And this organization was officially certified back in 2014 that it complied to the 29110 standard. Okay. And if you want to read more, there is an article on my website, or if you go on ResearchGate, you should be able to download it also. Now let's have a look at another company. In this case, it's a bank. Excuse me, large bank that employs also thousands of people in their IT division with that supports over 1,000 applications. And this organization, as my graduate student was working as the team leader of a team of six people. And those were the problems that their customer were reporting before they applied the basic profile in the organization. So those are typical complaints of customer because you deliver products late with defects, okay? And this is what the typical customer complained. So before they started to apply the basic profile, they took a snapshot of the actual process. So they took a picture. When I say a picture, they looked at the basic profile, the project management process of the basic profile, and they said, are we doing this task? Yes, yes, no, yes, no. And this is why you see 44% in the project planning stage and 67% in the project execution, and evaluation is 33%. In other words, 33% means only one out of three tasks were executed in the project management process. Now, and in the software development process, before applying the basic profile, they did the same exercise. And as you can see, it's much better, okay? About two-thirds, 63% of the tasks were executed. So remember what I said before, Technical people are good at doing technical stuff and they do it as I show you, but when it's time to manage a project, they don't do it very good. So don't be surprised if they get the problems that are listed at the bottom of my slides. Okay? No surprise. Okay. So if you don't manage correctly, you will have unhappy customers and will be delivering things late and things like that. Okay. So after they applied the basic profile, they measured the incidents that they had. In other words, complaints from customers. And each incident report has also an impact measure of 1 to 5. And as you can see, from the beginning on the left side to the right side, as they learned and improved and implemented the basic profile, the number of incidents and the number of impact of the incidents went from 17 to 1 and eventually to 0. Okay, so in other words, when they were delivering new version or new product to their the customers of the bank, the internal customer of the bank, it was what they called a non-event, no surprise. They were delivering the product in time, the product was meeting the needs of the customer, and the product had no failures in it. Okay. Another look in another company, a company with 500 employees, and that company had a very robust process to manage large projects, but their small or medium projects were not managed that well, or could be improved. So they decided to start a project to document project management process for small and medium projects. So they divided their portfolio of project using the criteria on the left, duration of a project, size of the team, the number of engineering specialties, the engineering fees, okay? And what they discovered was that 95% of the project they had in their portfolio were small or medium projects, okay? They had only 5% of the project were large projects. Mind you, the large projects are more expensive, but even that, 95% of the project had the deficient, if I could use this expression, or processes that could be largely improved. So they took the entry profile guide to implement the project management process of their small project, and they took the basic profile management process to develop their project management process for the medium projects. And for any process that you develop, costs money. Nothing is free, unfortunately. So you have to assemble a team, you have to identify problems, you have to document your process, you have to maybe develop a website, you have to develop checklists, you have to develop templates, you have to train project managers. And if you have a portfolio of dozens and dozens and dozens of projects, it means that every year, a project manager will be moved from one division of a company to another division. So you will have new project managers and you will have to train them. And as you use your processes, you will be improving the processes, you will be making modification to the website of the company. So they estimated the cost and benefits over 3 years. You can see that on the right side. So the cost of about 160,000 versus the benefits of about $780,000. So in other words, there is a return on investment of about 5 to 1. In other words, for every dollar spent to develop the process or implement the process, they had at least $1 of economy. In this case, they had $4 or $5 of economy per dollar invested. So that, in other words, it was a valuable, important contribution to the company. And if you want to read more, there is an article on my website and also on the ResearchGate. Let's have a quick look at system engineering. These are the components of a system. And as you can see in the middle, software is just one component of most systems. Very important component, I agree, because if the software is not there, the system doesn't work. Okay? So we have developed a roadmap exactly the same as the software engineering for systems. So same four steps. And no surprise, we have the same two processes, project management process on the left and the system engineering process on the right. The only difference between this slide and the previous one is here we are working at the system level. Okay, and at a certain time, the construction is also is constructing or buying hardware, buying cables, buying electronics, and developing the software and eventually testing the software and testing the hardware and eventually integrating software and system, software and hardware together to produce a system. So for the development of system, we say use the system engineering 29110. And if you have to develop software, we invite you to use the 29110 for software to develop your software component. And similarly, we have a set of deployment packages to support system engineering. Quick look at a company that uses the first company that uses the system engineering profile. It was established in 2012 with four people, and it's working in the transportation domain. And it used the basic profile as a foundation because many of their customers were requesting CMMI level 2. But it is impossible, almost impossible, for a startup to start a company at a CMMI level 2. The company has to make some money to make some profit when it develops their process and improves their process. So they decided to adopt the basic profile for system engineering as is, as a foundation to develop their first product. And as they grew, they developed processes for more complex product or less complex products. So on the left side, you have the process for small projects, like a prototype. They use the entry profile, the middle column for the standard process using the basic profile, and for the what they call the full process for large projects that require CMMI level 2, they have CMMI level 2. Okay. Quick look at the series of projects that have been completed in France 2 years ago now, just to show you that it has been applied in a wide range of domains, space, agriculture, nuclear, aeronautic, and automotive. And also in a wide range of size, from 10 employees to 150 employees, and also from a wide range of age, from being established back in 1994 to recently established in 2016. So they have successfully implemented the basic profile, system engineering basic profile. And if you want to read more, there is a six-page or seven-page article on that on my website. And from some publicity, we wrote a book, my colleagues, my French colleague and myself, in French, and we are meeting tomorrow, or yes, in 2 days, because we have translated the book from French to English, and the English version should be published next year. Yes. In academia right now, quick look. These are the countries that are teaching 29110. And you'll be happy to see that Ecuador is on the list. In Mexico, I was involved in project, I'll show you later on. So I don't want you to read the text, but what I want to make as a point is universities of the state of Zacatecas obtain a certification, an official ISO 29110 certification, as if they were a company. Okay, they went through the same audit process as a company, and they obtained a certificate from the Mexican certification organization. So that slide is presenting the fact that 29110 could be used in real universities. With in this case, those are the capstone projects that are being done by students working in teams. So yes, 29110 can be taught in academia and can be used in academia. And I'll let you read the advantage of the of 29110 for the software development centers. So typically, they obtain similar benefits than the company, than a standard company. Okay? We are also working to work on a game which is similar to the Monopoly. Now, this will be the Isopoly game that's being presently developed as an electronic game. And also, I've been working with people in Mexico over the last 3 years on a robot competition where students use the basic profile over a 3-day competition. So they use the project management process and they use the software implementation process to develop the software for the robots. So on the left side, you see one type of robot that we use twice, and the one on the right side for the sumo competition, the mini sumo competition that we had 2 years ago. So we asked the students over 3 days to produce just to go through 29110, but to produce a small number of documents, just a minimal. As you can see, 2-page project plan, 2-3-page specification, a few pages of test, traceability metrics, and 2 slides, because they were presenting their projects, they were presenting their documentation, they were presenting their lessons learned to the jury at the end of the competition, and they were also scored for the quality of their presentation. They were also evaluated for the quality of their documentation, and naturally, they were also evaluated if they won the competition. Okay. So if you want to know more, you can go on my website at the university. I have a page or a few pages in Spanish. Okay. Now some publicity for myself. Over the last years, with a colleague of mine at TTS, we've published on the left side a French textbook in about quality assurance. So what about 800 pages of textbook in French. And 2 years ago, we published with John Wiley and IEEE the textbook, a 600-page textbook about software quality assurance. And the house of quality that you have seen in my slides and that I will show you later on, the house of quality is used in my software quality assurance textbook. And we are working with colleagues to develop probably a Spanish version of the software quality assurance textbooks. Okay, so benefits. Let's see now that companies and academia have used 29110, let's see what a few countries have done. So this is an example of Thailand. Thailand has been involved in my working group since the very beginning back in 2005, and they have decided to have a national strategy about their digital economy, and 29110 was an important part of their strategy. So they have different government organizations that participate in the project, as well as VSEs and academia. And this is what they've done. So they have at least 10 universities that have been teaching 29110. And I was invited back in 2009 and in 2010 to teach at Chiang Mai University, at the Software Engineering School of Chiang Mai University, my software quality assurance course and the 29110. So they've been teaching 29110 since 2009 in Thailand. And this is the list of companies that have been certified. As you can see, 487 organizations have been certified in Thailand to 29110. So they want, as I said, 29110 is part of their strategy for the digital economy. So they put their act together. They have put money to train auditors, to train VSEs. They have put money to educate the professors in universities so that professor can teach 29110 at the universities. And the result is, as you can see, the number of VSEs that have been audited during the last few years. A quick look at, again, at Mexico. I've been working at the state in the state of Zacatecas since 2016 or 17, and we work on a plan with universities and company. We develop an action plan with the Secretary of Economy. Okay, the Secretary of Economy was sponsoring my visit to Zacatecas, and the objective was to promote the competitiveness of company. And also by helping universities in implementing and eventually getting certification. And I had a long discussion with the Secretary of Economy of Zacatecas. This gentleman is an engineer, so he was very, very accepted very well the concept that if their economy wanted to improve their competitiveness, the 29110 could be a good mechanism to do that. So, an example, back right in 2017, four companies got certified to 29110. Okay. And as you can see, they're small, okay? 4, 3, 7, and 12 people. So you, and at the bottom, you can see the logo of those companies. So if we look at the state of Zacatecas in 2017, they had 8 organizations that have been certified by the Mexican organization. In 2018-19, they had an additional 7 organizations that were certified, including 5 universities. And now they have an additional 5 organizations getting certified, including 2 universities. So now we have 11 universities in the state of Zacatecas that are certified to 29110. And if you want to read more, we've published an article in 2018 about that with my colleagues from Zacatecas, the Professor Amerna and Yezrel from CIMAT in Zacatecas. Now, so I demonstrated to you why we did develop the standard. What we developed, I gave you just a brief look at the inside of the basic profile. I showed you that it has been applied in many VSEs and in many universities. So we did our first survey back in 2005, and we wanted to verify back in 2018 if we did satisfy the users of our community. So the users are the VSEs, their customers, the assessors, and the professors. And Mirna was instrumental in getting the survey translated from English to Spanish. So one question we asked them is, how long after you implemented 29110 did you notice improvement to your productivity? So here you can see that in the first few months, many VSEs noticed improvements in productivity. We asked the same thing about quality, okay? And you can also notice that many VSEs achieve increase in quality improvement soon after implementing 29110. And we asked them about their overall satisfaction. Okay, so 89% are completely or largely satisfied about their implementation of 29110. Now it's nice to have happy VSEs, but the bottom line is, do you also have happy customers of VSEs? So we ask the same questions to the customer, and this is the answer. So close to 80% of their customers were completely or largely satisfied with the VSC that supplied products to them. And we asked the reason for teaching 29110, and some of the reasons were to teach basic software engineering principles, to teach project management, to teach the standard, to teach the importance of software quality assurance, and sometimes because local company or the government were interested in 29110. And as I said, it's been taught by academia for at least 9 years now. Again, why do you teach 29110 from the point of view of the professor? It's because it's easy to understand, students are motivated to use them, and there is some teaching material available. So if you want to read more, an article which has been published a month ago in IEEE Computer describes roughly what I just talked about there. Now, the benefits, okay, the day-to-day benefits. So I'll let you read this. And similarly, commercial benefits for our organization, whether they are a public organization like a government team or a private company that works to make profit, there are benefits for them. And I stress the lower part of my slides where reduction of rework would mean maybe higher profit, maybe shorter development time, and most probably being more competitive because the cost will be less and also development time will be less. And most probably the quality level will be higher than your competitors. Okay. Now on the next steps, I want to emphasize the bottom part where you see the two red arrows. In a few weeks, we will have a meeting with my working group members and we'll be reviewing the guide, the Agile guide. The Agile guide has been developed by people from Mexico. It has been sent for a review cycle in ISO. And in about 2 weeks, I will get the comments made by the experts of different countries. And during our meeting of WGN24 in mid-October, we will review the comments to make the modification to the Agile guide and eventually send the Agile guide for publication to ISO. So that Agile guide should be published in 2021. At the same meeting in mid-October, we should have a first review of the draft of the DevOps guide, and it will go through the same cycle. After we finish review it, it will be sent for a review cycle within ISO, and I suspect that this guide will be available for you at the end of 2021 or at the beginning of 2022. And we're also working on the new guides and new requirements specification for the space domain, and I'll show you in a few seconds a few organizations that are participating to this project. So the Agile guide that is being developed and reviewed has two objectives: is to reinforce VSCs that are already using some Agile approach, because the guide will tell them more specifically what they have to do. They will have now a documented process, a documented Agile process to help them develop their product. And for VSCs that have been using the basic profile in, let's say, a more waterfall approach, then the guide will also show them how to use the basic profile in an Agile approach. And those are the organizations that are participating to the development of the space guides and the space specification. So again, their objective is to develop a series of VSCs around the world that could be certified to the space profile such that they can get contract from those space agencies. Okay. And they're using we're using the basic profile, and we are adding a few requirements from the European space standards, because as I didn't mention, but the generic, the guides that we have developed are called generic because they apply to a wide range of domain. But in this case, we are in a very specific domain, the space domain. So we use the basic profile as a foundation, and then the experts from the space domain are adding what is missing for them in the space domain in the basic profile. So they're adding a few requirements from the space standards. Okay. Quality assurance, what is needed to produce quality? It's like a clock mechanism. It means that different parts of the clock have to work together, either sequentially or in parallel, such that at the end, the time is correct, and the time is right. And same thing for software development. At the end, if everything is in place, everything works correctly, everything works smoothly, then you should have a good software product, quality software product delivered in time within budget. Again, the quality house that I showed from the book, this is the same quality house, but highlighting in red the links between 29110 and the elements of the house of quality. Okay. So in other words, as an example, we talk about traceability in the quality assurance book, and in 29110, we ask the software developer to establish the traceability between the requirements and the architecture, between the architecture and the code, and between the code and the test cases, and eventually the results of the test cases. So in other words, concepts taught in the book are being used in 29110. Okay, getting to the end. Recommendation in conclusion. So for academia, I recommend that that professor teach 29110 and student use 29110 in different courses, like the requirements course, because there is a requirements activity in 29110. There is an architecture activity in 29110. There is a project management process in 29110. So students can learn parts and pieces of 29110 in different courses. And also they should apply 29110 in projects. Government organizations, they should implement like they did, like they're doing in Thailand, as an example, in their own software project internally. Okay? They should educate their suppliers, their software suppliers, about 29110, which is what they did in Thailand. They should motivate their suppliers and implement 29110, and this is what they did in Thailand. They say in Thailand, if you want to do business with the government, go and get certified. Okay? If you want to get credits, tax benefits, go and get certified. Okay? And also motivate academia to teach 29110. And for companies, they should implement 29110 internally in their own projects. And customer should motivate their suppliers in implementing 29110 because it brings them benefit. Okay, as you've seen before, both VCs and customers are happy about 29110. So why are they not using it? And for suppliers, they should implement 29110 in their software project, and also educate their customer about the benefits of 29110. And by the way, also communicate their needs to academia. So going back to this slide, okay, you remember what we talked about 2 hours ago. So if you can provide these process measures, then you are really managing software development, right? And if you can provide the product measures, then you know if you are developing quality software. And most probably, if you have those measures, you know how well you're managing your project, and you know how good your process and your development teams are, okay? Conclusion. 29110 was developed specifically for VSEs having less or up to 25 people that develop either systems or software. We developed 29110 because VSE don't have the time, not the expertise to adapt existing complex standards to their needs. We have developed a 4-stage roadmap for VSEs to go from startups to grown-ups. We have at least 20 countries teaching 29110 at the graduate and undergraduate level. And 29110 has been used successfully in government agencies, in startups, in grown-ups, in large enterprises, in many countries. And finally, 29110 brings many economical benefits and other benefits to the VSEs, their customers, their business partners, and their employees. So going back to the 1968 conference, NATO conference, in 2020, this is my observation. Again. But my question are as follow. Why do a large number of software organizations either ignore or don't use software practices that have been available since the 1970s? Why? Is it because many developers and managers have a big ego? In other words, we don't need that. We know that. We know everything. We good. Okay. So we don't need standards. We don't need software quality assurance practices. Why are so many software people not working smarter and not using the proven practices? Okay. And I'll let you read this. Okay, so thank you very much. Maybe we have time for questions, I don't know.
Thank you, Claude. Unfortunately, we run out of time. And, if you can help us, I can send you the questions so you can help us answering them, and we can discuss with the students next week, because okay. It's already out of time. Unless somebody wants to ask something, at this point, you can do that. Yeah, I guess it's because it's lunchtime and the students have another class sooner. So,
no problem.
Thank you very much, Bexi. Gracias, Yupachani in Quichua. Thank you very much. It was very good for us to have you here and to listen to you from your experience and your point of view. What can we do to improve our profession, our industry, and the quality of the products we develop?
Yes.
So I hope to see you soon. And thanks, everybody, also. Muchas gracias a todos. Eso sería todo por hoy. Nos vemos la próxima semana. Un pequeño anuncio nada más. El aula virtual está caída en este momento, pero cuando ustedes ingresen van a ver una tarea pequeña esta semana que es solamente de lectura. Leer el capítulo 4 y anotar las preguntas que ustedes puedan tener sobre ese capítulo para discutirlas la próxima clase, donde también vamos a definir cómo va a ser el examen. Claude, I don't know if you want to say anything else.
No. Thank you very much for the invitation. And please do not hesitate if you want me to talk about other topics about quality assurance. We can do another workshop like that, another presentation like this. Okay?
Thank you very much and have a good afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Very amazing. It's very amazing your job, Claude. I am very impressed with your desires. Thank you. I have a question, only one question. If reviews is the best control, how, do you know how I can fight against the delivery time of my product?
Oops, the sound is cutting. What I suggest that you do is you send your question to Sandra, and Sandra will send your question by email, and I will answer your question by email, okay?
Okay.
I lost the voice. I lost the sound. Okay?
Okay.
Sorry.
Don't have a problem. Take care a lot.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Gracias con todos y nos vemos la próxima clase. No se olviden de revisar la tarea. Hasta luego con todos.
Gracias, hasta luego.
Hasta luego, profe.
Hablamos la próxima semana. Chao. David, mándame la pregunta para poder mandarle a Cloud.
Listo, profe. ¿Le envío por WhatsApp? O...
Sí, es que justo se te cortó el audio y casi no se te escuchó.
Sí, es que mi internet está medio.
Otra vez se te cortó. Mándame por WhatsApp. Hasta ya, luego.
Bien, hasta luego.
Cuídense mucho. Chao, chao.
Hasta luego, Inge.
Chao, chicos. Una buena tarde. Nos vemos la próxima semana.